Let me take this opportunity to give a brief background of the organization. Spectra Dynamics has the head office in Vadodara, and it has sales support office in Mumbai and Delhi. We provide consulting services mainly to process industry, involving conceptual design, front-end engineering design, some part of detail engineering activities, and we also provide advanced process solutions, wherein we offer simulation-based services, advanced process control to operating plants, and also the integrated engineering software solution. In short span of time of less than 3 years, we have been able to execute more than 40 projects to the industry leaders from different industry segments. You can reach www.specdynamics.com for more details about Spectra Dynamics. So the agenda that I have charted for this seminar is the distillation columns. Very basics about distillation column. I'm sure you have had quite deep sessions on the design and thermodynamic and simulation aspects of distillation column. The main emphasis of this presentation would be on column internals, including trays versus pack columns, random packing, structured packing, and pack column internals as well. So in the distillation column, you know that the feed, the above feed, this section is the rectification section, and below that is the stripping section. There is a condenser for condensing the vapors to create reflux, which will be part of it will be reflux pack, and the distillate product comes out from the top. And there is a reboiler for generating the vapor so as to achieve vapor liquid traffic within the column. So the main objective of the distillation column internals is to achieve the vapor liquid contact. In the design aspect, the height of the column is determined by the difficulty in separation. Difficulty in separation would depend upon the desired purity of the products and what is the relative volatility between the different components of the solution from which the separation is to be achieved. Height also will get determined by the kind of the amount of energy that you will be putting in to achieve the distillation column, and it will also depend on the efficiency of internals. So if you design a distillation column wherein you have you are putting a very large heat input, then you would have a height which would be reduced significantly because of higher vapor that will be getting generated, so higher vapor liquid traffic. So number of theoretical stages that would be required would get reduced. So we will have to strike a balance between the we will have to optimize in such a way that the heat consumption is such as the operating cost and capital cost is balanced out. The diameter of the column is determined by the vapor liquid traffic that the column is going to column has to handle. So the amount of liquid that is getting fed, the amount of stripping vapor, and the reflux, based on that the hydraulic calculation is required to be carried out to determine the diameter for a distillation column. The diameter of the column would also depend upon the operating pressure. Higher the operating pressure, the vapor density will be lesser, vapor density will be higher, and hence the column diameter would reduce. So if you are operating a column under vacuum, then because the vapor density is very less, for the same amount of mass flow of vapor, the volumetric flow will be much larger, and hence the diameter of the column that is required will turn out to be much larger. The diameter will also depend upon the capacity of the internals. That means the capacity to handle the vapor liquid traffic of a particular internal would determine the diameter of the column. So essentially, I am going to talk about different column internals and its capability with respect to its efficiency and its capability with respect to its vapor liquid handling capability. So for carrying out process calculation for achieving the diameter, identifying the diameter and the height of the column, there are various studies that is required to be done. Process calculations, the simulation studies will arrive at, based on that you will arrive at the number of theoretical stages that is required, which would, depending upon the efficiency of the internal, it will translate into the height of the distillation column. And based on these calculations, you will also generate the vapor liquid traffic within the column, based on which the diameter of the column would get determined. There are various simulation software packages to identify the number of theoretical stages that is required and the vapor liquid traffic to achieve desired separation for the required purities, for the required throughput and capacities. Okay, so number of theoretical stages for trade column based on tray efficiencies will translate into number of trays. So, and for the packing, based on packing HETP, that is the height equivalent to theoretical plate, it will translate into the height of the packed plate. I'm sure all these are basic concepts and you would be aware of these things. I'm just giving a very brief idea about this so that in my subsequent discussion I can refer to some of these aspects. The based on the vapor liquid traffic, the hydraulic design calculations are carried out. There are various methodologies of hydraulic design calculation, right from the generalized pressure drop correlation curve, the and the proprietary softwares developed by different distillation column internals vendors. So based on that, the pressure drop across the internals is calculated and the operating point with respect to flooding capacities is also calculated. In the column internals, there are various process requirements. So the primary requirement is to achieve the desired efficiency and to achieve the to handle the desired capacities. These are two main fundamental primary requirement for any column internal. So what the column internal, what it does is it allows to achieve a vapor liquid contact which can be as intimate as possible to achieve good amount of interaction for transfer of light component from one phase to another phase in order to achieve the separation. The secondary requirements, which are also equally important, is the pressure drop consideration, the resistance to fouling and the resistance to corrosion. So based on this primary requirement and the secondary requirement, the selection of the column internals is determined. There are various types of column internals like trays, random packing, structured packing, the grids and the packed column internals. Okay. In a trade column, this is a picture of a single pass cross flow tray. So in which from the downcomer of the tray above, the liquid will enter onto the tray and it will flow across the tray and go to the next downcomer to feed it to the tray below. Whereas the vapor will flow from bottom of the tray to the next tray on the top. So that is how it is called as a cross flow tray. So here we have to understand one important thing, that this is the desired flow path of vapor and liquid. The liquid has to flow across the tray and the vapor has to come from bottom and go to the tray above. Now for example, if the liquid which is flowing across, if there is not sufficient resistance from vapor, and if this liquid through the holes of the tray, if it instead of going to the downcomer here, if it falls down in the tray below, then it is not getting sufficient residence time on the tray to achieve the vapor liquid contact. So this will result in deterioration in the efficiency. Similarly, when the vapor which is coming from bottom and going to the tray above, if it carries some liquid of this tray onto the tray above, then it is it results in axial back mixing, which again deteriorates the concentration gradient, which would result in deterioration in the efficiency. Okay, this is same thing but with a different picture. Now the downcomer will have some liquid in order to ensure that the vapor from tray below doesn't enter the downcomer, because downcomer is the place where the vapor liquid disengagement should take place. When the vapor is flowing from the tray below to tray above, at that point of time there is some froth which is generated onto the tray, and there is a tendency that some amount of clear liquid, majority of clear liquid and some froth will go into the downcomer. So the job of the downcomer is to provide sufficient residence time, sufficient residence volume and time in order to allow the vapor and liquid disengagement in the downcomer, so that the vapor of the say tray number 10 will not go to tray number 9 below, but it will go to tray number 11 above, and the clear liquid will go to the tray below. So these are the components of the trade column. So this is the downcomer, this is the active tray area wherein the actual contact between vapor and liquid takes place, during which the mass transfer actually takes place, and this is the outlet where which gives which ensures that there is some amount of liquid pool onto the tray deck to achieve the contact between vapor and liquid, and from the outlet where it will go to the downcomer and from the downcomer it will go to the next the tray below.
So this height of the wear,
yeah,
is it little more than the gap on the downcomer side, so that there is a liquid seal?
Correct. See, this liquid sealing is important so that vapor should not enter the downcomer. So in the typical situation, the height of the exit wear is higher than the downcomer clearance, so that the downcomer clearance is always filled up with the liquid and vapor doesn't enter, which is called as a static seal. I would come to the next stage where it's a dynamic seal, wherein the exit wear height can be lesser than the downcomer clearance. I'll talk about that when it comes to high performance trays. Okay, so this is the straight downcomer, this is clearance under downcomer, that is downcomer clearance, this is the outlet wear, this is a seal plate which is a flat seal plate, and this length from the downcomer panel to the exit wear is called as a flow path length. That is the length of the liquid flow path, and that is why it is called as a flow path length, during which the actual vapor and liquid gets in contact with each other to achieve the mass transfer. This area, this cross sectional area here, is called as a bubbling area, where the vapor gets contacted onto the liquid pool on the tray above. This area is the free area, because after the vapor gets an intimate contact with the liquid, there is a tendency of foam, froth formation, and the free area in this zone is basically, it also again gives time to separate the vapor from liquid, and vapor has to go up and liquid has to flow to the downcomer. Any deterioration in this path, say vapor is going to the downcomer and to the next tray below, or liquid from the tray below is going to tray above, is the actual back mixing, which would lead to deterioration in the efficiency. This one is the inlet wear. So at times when the static seal is not available, meaning that the downcomer clearance is higher than the exit wear height, that means there is no static seal available. So at that point of time, we can have an inlet wear which is taller than the exit wear height. Then it will provide the sealing of the downcomer to avoid the vapor flow through the downcomer. So this is one case. Even in conventional trays, you can have the inlet wear to avoid that situation. Now you might come with a thought that why the downcomer clearance at first place, why not we keep lesser to avoid the inlet wear itself? Now there are possibilities wherein the liquid load on the tray is very high, and if you keep say 50 mm of the downcomer under downcomer clearance, now you have a certain diameter, and when the liquid is coming only through that rectangular box of 50 mm height and whatever that cord length is, it will have certain velocity. Now as you go up on the liquid loading, that velocity will increase. Higher the velocity, whatever vapor is coming from below, it will push that vapor towards the downcomer. Now when vapor is going pushed towards the downcomer, then there is more froth which will be there in the downcomer, and the downcomer capacity will become inadequate. Downcomer capacity with respect to vapor liquid disengagement will become inadequate because of higher liquid velocities under the downcomer. So to reduce the liquid velocities under the downcomer, we need to increase the downcomer clearance, under downcomer clearance. So you get more rectangular area So your velocity, liquid velocity is flowing on entering velocity on the tray would reduce, and in turn it will avoid the possibility of froth getting pushed into the, more and more froth getting pushed into the downcomer. So in such a situation, when you are exceeding the limit, or you are exceeding the exit wear height, at that point of time the requirement of inlet wear will come. Now you can think that even the exit wear height we would increase to avoid the inlet wear, but as we increase the exit wear height, then the liquid pool on the tray deck will increase, because you are increasing the exit wear height. When the liquid pool is increasing, there is a higher resistance for vapor upflow, which will translate into higher pressure drop. So these are a few important considerations while deciding a type of the tray and while carrying out the hydraulic design for a tray column. You can see here that this one was the straight downcomer, whereas this is a slanted downcomer. This is a completely a sloped downcomer. The slope downcomer trays are typically used wherein the liquid handling capacity is lesser and vapor handling capacity required is higher. So once we slope it here, then the active area is increasing, because the downcomer the downcomer width is reducing in the bottom. So you can see here that in this zone, in this zone here, the flow path length and bubbling area is only this much. Whereas since you have slanted the tray, you can get more active area, more bubbling area. So you can have now more vapor handling capacity. Okay. So these are few of the tray terminologies which we have already discussed about. This is the inlet panel, this side. This is the manway panel. This manway panel is essentially used during the installation of the tray. When the trays are installed, it is installed from typically from bottom to top. So the installation person would install all the components of the tray except the manway panel, and then he will go on the tray above, again install all the components of the tray except the manway. So say if there are 20 trays, when the trays are installed, all the 20 manway panels of each the panel of each tray, manway panel, would not be installed, and the inspector will inspect whether the trays has been installed correctly, and then from bottom to top it will keep on boxing up the manway panel, and he will come out from the top manhole. So that is the function of the manway panel. Now there are few things which are not appearing on slide. Now the tray would reside on something called as a tray support ring, and it is clamped. The tray panels are clamped onto the tray support ring. Then this is the downcomer part, and this portion is called as downcomer beam. Actually it is a downcomer panel, but which gives a mechanical support to the tray, and that's why it is called as a downcomer beam. And this is also a bottom part of downcomer panel. So the downcomer is again clamped onto downcomer bolting bar. So there is a vertical tower attachment on which the downcomer panels are bolted. This is the exit wear, and on the tray deck you will have different kinds of active units, either valve or sieve or bubble caps, and this entire part is called as active panel. In the cross flow trays, the single pass trays or multi pass trays are there. Basically single pass meaning the liquid flows across the tray only once, and then only one flow path is there for liquid flow, whereas in the multi-pass tray, the or two-pass tray as shown here, the liquid comes from two side downcomers of the tray above and goes to the center downcomer, again gets split into the two side downcomers. So this is the picture of a two-pass tray. You can have even four-pass tray or even odd number, three-pass tray also has been designed. The consideration of multi-pass tray comes from the requirement of additional liquid handling capabilities, and depending upon the column diameter. So liquid from tray above is going to the center downcomer, and it is splitting on both sides and goes to the side downcomer. Again it will merge, it will come together and go into the center downcomer. Now you can imagine that say if there is a column of depending upon vapor velocities and liquid velocities if you design a column with 4 meter diameter. Now, in a similar column in say 1.5 meter diameter, the liquid flow path length, if we consider two the inlet panel and downcomer panel each of say 300 mm and 300 mm, then you get a liquid flow path length of 900 mm. So 1500 minus 300 minus 300, so 900 is the flow path length. Now, when liquid is traveling across the tray and vapor is getting vapor is contacting the liquid, up to certain length, the when the liquid travels, whatever mass transfer has to occur has occurred, and then any additional travel is not going to really yield with respect to additional mass transfer, because whatever, depending upon the efficiency of the internal, whatever mass transfer was to take place on that particular tray, that has been achieved. So any additional length is not contributing to the mass transfer for the additional vapor liquid contact, because whatever equilibrium was to be achieved has been achieved. Now, that additional length is a waste. Now, when you go for a 4 meter diameter column, you can imagine if you have a single pass tray and say 400 mm of the downcomer width on both sides, so you will have almost 3.2 meters of flow path length. So maybe after 1.5 meter or 2.2 meters, there is no mass transfer that is taking place on the tray, but it is just because of maybe higher vapor velocities for which the diameter is considered to be 4 meter. Now, in such a case, when you go for multi-pass trays, then you can have the liquid distributed in the two passes or four passes for that matter, and the flow path length is just more than adequate with respect to the mass transfer efficiency requirement. So you are improving the tray efficiency also, and you are reducing the column diameter to a certain extent when you switch from single pass to multi-pass tray for a larger diameter column. So instead of 4 meter single pass tray, probably you can achieve the same task within 3 meter multi-pass tray. These are various downcomer types: straight downcomer, slope downcomer with recessed inlet area. I will come to some of these concepts in the next slides, why this recessed inlet area is provided. Then there is a step downcomer. Then when the liquid handling capacities are very less, then it's a pipe downcomer. And there are circular downcomers, swept back weir, the seal pan and the draw off pan. The let me explain one concept of this swept back weir. In the hydraulic calculation, there is an important term called height of liquid over weir per length of weir. This terminology or this parameter is useful in arriving at the downcomer pressure drop. So when you have a very high liquid velocities above the exit weir and you have no space to increase the downcomer width. See, if you increase the downcomer width, your chord length will increase. Downcomer width is say this portion, this is the downcomer width. So if you increase this downcomer width to this extent, then your chord length, the wear length would increase. So by increasing wear length, you are reducing this parameter, that is height of the height of liquid over wear divided by wear length, or it is actually eventually converted into gallons per meter of liquid flow divided by length of wear, GPM per LWI, which contributes into pressure drop calculation. So to achieve lesser number of GPM per length of wear, you need to increase the chord length. So to increase the chord length, you can increase the downcomer width. But if you increase the downcomer width, the active area available for vapor upflow would reduce, and again it will contribute to higher pressure drop. Okay, so these are the, we have discussed these parameters like capacity, efficiency, turndown, pressure drop and fouling resistance. Turndown is an important aspect while designing as well as selecting the type of internal. Because when we design a column, we have to have flexibility in terms of the operating capacities as well as in terms of if the feed composition is changing for a certain distillation column depending upon the availability of say crude or type of crude, then at that point of time the required reflux ratios to achieve same level of purification would differ. So if the reflux ratios are changing to achieve the same level of purification, that means the column has to handle that different vapor liquid traffic at different operating conditions or feed conditions. So we have to design column internals to suit all those two, three types of crude to achieve the same level of separation. For example, even in certain cases where it's in the upstream there is a reaction and downstream there is a separation, and reaction is catalyst based. So when the catalyst activity is good at the start of the run, you would have certain feed composition to the column. Whereas when the catalyst activity has deteriorated, that is called as end of run, then the feed composition would be different. So the column internals will have to be designed not only for the feed composition which is at the start of run of the catalyst, but also up to the end of run of the catalyst. Pressure drop and fouling resistance. There are certain services which are fouling. So based on the fouling characteristics, different types of internals are chosen. I will come to the types of internals and I will talk about the ability of the fouling resistance for different types. Flooding and entrainment we have briefly talked about. These are the two important parameters, flooding, entrainment, pressure drop, while arriving at the design of the column internals. So flooding essentially occurs when the vapor and liquid flow rate exceeds the capacity of the column, and that is why flooding is an important parameter while sizing the distillation column. So the symptoms is and basically the flooded tray would act as a restriction to the liquid flow down to the next tray, and the symptoms are build up of liquid and excessive pressure drop across that zone. So two types of flooding. One is the downcomer flooding, which is basically high flow and small tray spacing, and jet flooding, which is low flow but excessive liquid entrainment. The liquid entrainment, it increases with higher hole vapor velocities, and also it increases due to reduced tray spacing. So as you reduce the tray spacing, the probability of entrainment would increase, and as the vapor velocities go up, or if you put to achieve lesser pressure drop, you will have more active units, more holes or more sieve holes or walls to achieve lesser pressure drop, but because of which you can also reduce, with the help of that you can also reduce the vapor velocities to reduce the entrainment. If you reduce the number of holes, then the vapor velocity will increase and it will lead higher pressure drop, as well as it will lead to higher probability of liquid entrainment. The liquid entrainment will decrease with increased liquid wear load and increased fractional perforated area, and also surface tension would play a significant role in the liquid entrainment. Lesser the surface tension, the probability of entrainment is higher. Okay, so this is typically these are various considerations while carrying out the hydraulic design for any kind of trade column, based on the liquid flow and gas flow rates. And as shown here, this is the best operating point at the center. So if you have very less liquid flow and very high gas flow rate, then it will lead to entrainment. If you have very high liquid flow rate and very less gas flow rate, then it will lead to downcomer choke flood. If you have very high liquid rate and very less gas flow rate, then it will lead to weeping. Weeping is another phenomenon wherein when liquid is flowing across the tray, the liquid has to go to the downcomer to go to the next tray below. But if the liquid weeps through the valve or holes before it goes to the downcomer, that is called as weeping, when it leaks through the holes. So that would result in channeling, which would result in reduction in the mass transfer efficiencies. And dumping is nothing but when the liquid is when the reflux is falling from top, it instead of having any horizontal component of velocity, it directly dumps through the hole to the tray below, again through the hole to the tray below. And bed expansion, priming, is very high velocities of gas, and which will lead to entrainment and bed expansion. So all these things are to be avoided, and this is the best suited operating point so as to have margins with respect to turn down flexibility as well. Okay, we all know the various types of conventional trays: sieve tray, bubble cap tray, and a floating wall tray. This is just a picture with respect to how a bubble cap tray would look like, and this is during the shop, the testing of with respect to dimension test. This is the mock assembly to check whether the dimensions are appropriate so that when it goes to the site, it would enter the column properly. Okay, sieve trays, these are easy to manufacture and very inexpensive, because you can realize there is a single unit unit operation with respect to manufacture of tray. It is just the punching of the plate to make a sieve tray. There are no any additional mechanical operation. It has good efficiency at design conditions only. The turndown flexibility is very poor. The moment vapor liquid traffic is changing, you don't have any means to have a better turndown flexibility in case of a sieve tray. It is good in fouling applications, because there are no obstruction, so no reduced possibility of getting sedimentation or choking. Corrosion problem is lesser, even though sometimes holes may get damaged because of high velocities and some kind of erosion related corrosion. In case of bubble cap tray, though many of the bubble cap trays have been replaced with sieve tray or wall tray, but there are still certain applications where bubble cap trays are required to be used for its very good tray efficiency, because when vapor escapes from the bubble cap tray, it rises through the riser, takes the U-turn, and from the bubble cap it enters into the liquid, and after having contact with liquid only, it will get escaped to the tray above. So it ensures the very good contact between vapor and liquid, and during which it exerts higher pressure drop. This is one concept that I would like to highlight here, that in case of bubble cap tray, the contact between vapor and liquid is very good, because of which the efficiencies of the bubble cap tray is good. But the pressure drop is high because of the two U-turns that the vapor has to take from the tray below to tray above. Now, the mechanism of ensuring the vapor liquid contact with the help of bubble cap tray is such that it has to take these two U-turns. But actually, in the vapor liquid contact, in the contact, these two U-turns are not contributing. It is a wasteful pressure drop. It is not a useful pressure drop. When it actually contacts the liquid, at that point of time, whatever pressure drop is occurring, that is a useful pressure drop, which is contributing into mass transfer. Whereas this two U-turns is not really contributing into the useful pressure drop for the tray. So I would use this example or this concept to highlight that higher pressure drop means higher efficiency, as long as that pressure drop is contributing into mass transfer. But if the higher pressure drop out of, like in bubble cap tray, very large part of it is not contributing into the mass transfer, then it is unnecessarily spending more energy. So on this concept, lot of development subsequently took place, that there has to be a contact which is useful to achieve mass transfer. So whatever that pressure drop is occurring, it has to be a useful pressure drop and not a wasteful pressure drop. Here also the bubble caps would obstruct the liquid flow when the liquid is flowing across the tray. Typically certain absorbers, wherein the liquid used for as an absorbent is say DM water, which is an expensive feed, or any other kind of solvents which are expensive, but absorption is required to be done. Then in such applications, sometimes or quite often the bubble cap trays are used, because in such case the liquid load required is very less and vapor load handled is high, and at the same time efficiency required is much larger. Okay, in wall trays there are essentially two types, moving valve and fixed valve. The moving valve tray will, as shown here in the picture, will have a tray deck and a moving valve, which will move up and down depending upon the vapor flow from below. Whereas in the fixed valve tray, the valves will be punched out of the deck itself. So that is the fixed valve tray. Moving valves, the valves moves up and down as per vapor load. Movement is restricted by valve legs. So the maximum lift will depend upon the leg length of the valve. And this is one type of valve, which is a legged valve. Then there is a caged valve, wherein there is a cage and a disc. So depending upon the vapor load, the disc will move up and down. Because of this functionality, it offers larger turn down flexibility as compared to a sieve tray or a bubble cap tray. So when the vapor load is very high, the walls will be 100% open. 100% of the walls will be 100% open. That will be the maximum capacity that can be achieved by a wall tray, a moving wall tray. Whereas say if you are operating a column at 50% capacity, then 50% of the walls will be closed and 50% will be open. If there are two different types of walls within the wall tray, light walls and heavy walls. The adjacent rows, light wall, heavy wall, these kind of rows can be arranged on the tray deck. So when the vapor loads are less, all light walls will be open and heavy walls will be closed. So the vapor distribution across the tray, across the cross section of the column also will remain same, because you are keeping one line of light, one line of heavy. So at low vapor loads, heavy walls will be sitting onto the tray deck, and only light walls will be open and vapor will be going through the light walls. Pitch would remain same. Effective pitch is changing in the turndown condition. But typically,
when the flow rate is much more,
the pitch would reduce.
In that case, the light wall, they will be at the maximum
light as well as
core pressure.
Yeah, the light wall will be fully open. Even the heavy wall will be fully open. At the highest flow condition, both the walls will be fully open.
What I am saying is, the stresses on the lighter wall probably will be much more than
true, that is true. But the mechanical design is such that it will take care of it, and the escape area across the walls would remain same because the leg length is same. So the pressure drop across the walls would remain same, and the pitch part of it, when we design the column, at that point of time, the pitch is determined based on the highest flow condition, and so as to ensure that proper mixing also is taking place and proper vapor liquid contact is taking place. But in the low flow condition, actual number of wall requirement is reduced, so you can have larger pitch, whereas in high flow condition you need to have more number of walls, so pitch gets automatically reduced. So it balances between pressure drop and the vapor liquid contact. In case of fixed wall tray, the tray walls are punched out of the tray deck and the opening remains fixed. So in case of fixed wall tray, the operating turndown flexibility is reduced as compared to moving wall tray. So wall trays would offer better turndown situations, more flexible when the feed rate is varying. Efficiency remains same even though the gas drops, the gas rate drops, and walls are more likely to plug or foul because it has the legs, the more obstruction, so more tendency to fouling.
Pressure in the column. Suppose right. I am operating a column at 6 PM pressure. Mm-hmm. At 6 PM pressure, I am supplying say 10,000 gas per hour.
Okay.
And 10,000 has become 5,000.
Correct.
But the pressure I am making 6 PM, same 6 PM.
Top pressure, operating pressure.
Operating pressure.
Okay.
Pressure hasn't come down. So even in that case also, it will come down.
The pressure drop across the tray would slightly reduce. So bottom pressure might change. As long as if you are controlling the top pressure, then the bottom pressure would change depending upon at a higher or lesser vapor load. Now, but at the same time, the pressure drop during low flow condition would be lesser and high flow condition will be higher. So the bottom pressure would change if you are maintaining the top operating pressure. Yeah, now if you are having the turndown flexibility by means of a wall tray, now imagine a situation wherein for 100%, if you don't have a flexibility, then
I'm just reducing the flow rate, not the pressure. I'm being able to control the pressure fully.
Okay, so now if you are using a wall tray in such situation, then what will happen is the escape area, the vapor escape area in case of higher flow rate is say X. When you are reducing the throughput, the vapor flow, at that point of time the escape area will reduce.
Yes,
and now for reduced escape area you have reduced vapor flow rate, but pressure drop may not be same but slightly lesser, but will not be lesser in proportionate, say at 100% you had a pressure drop of across the column of 2 kg, and now at 50% the pressure drop will not be 1 kg because you are reducing the escape area. So pressure drop, if not 2, it may be 1.8 or 1.9. So pressure drop, and this is the it's a good question, let me explain this. If you are changing the pressure drop, then bottom pressure would change. If bottom pressure is changing, the bottom saturation temperature will change. If that is changing, then your bottom product purity would change. And this is the concept of having better operating flexibility. So even at lower flow conditions, we need to maintain similar pressure drop to achieve similar bottom temperature. And that's the reason where this wall tray will be useful when at lower operating conditions, you have lesser openings and hence similar pressure drop, so as to achieve the bottom column bottom pressure to achieve the temperature and purity.
So this one side as far as down is considered. Now when you consider over capacity running, normally how much can we go up?
See, 20%? Typically it depends upon the type of tray that has been used. Say for example, wall tray. Yeah, you might have to rush little bit because it is 12:15. I have to cover random packing as well as structured packing. So, but I don't. Please don't hesitate to ask me questions. Dual flow trays, basically, it has the vapor and liquid flow path in the same. There is no downcomer. Baffle trays are good for heat transfer application, and it can handle very large amount of solid and coke. Disc and donut trays and ripple trays are few other example of the dual flow trays. Chimney trays are the trays which are used for collecting or partial draw or segregating between two different sections, but these are not essential, these are not mass transfer devices, these are transition trays. ERD trays are extra resistant design trays. For example, in certain fertilizer complexes, there are very high flow rate of gas at high pressure, and the bottom most tray would see very large impact momentum. So the bottom 2 or 5 trays are designed with additional mechanical strengthening. Those trays are called ERD trays. The process consideration remains same, but the mechanical considerations differs drastically. So there the tray manway panel strengthening, tray hardware, truss ends and tri trusses are required to additionally strengthen the trays. So this is the tray development timeline. So around 1930s or 25, the bubble cap tray was invented and started in commercial use. Around 1955, the sieve and wall trays were evolved, and in late 19 wall tray, yes, both of these were parallelly evolved. Considering the fact that bubble cap are expensive to manufacture, it offers very large amount of pressure drop, and they industry people and scientists started realizing that there is lot of energy which is getting wasted, lot of pressure drop which is not contributing into the mass transfer. So that is how these concepts of sieve tray and wall tray came into picture. And then in 1990s, the high performance trays came into picture. All this while, the drivers for advancement were to increase in efficiency, to achieve more intimate contact between vapor and liquid, increase in capacity to maximize the useful pressure drop, optimize the revamp cost and time so that the cutting and welding required is minimum, because companies had installed columns and they realized that instead of 120 tons per day, now they need to manufacture 150 tons per day, and they still have good demand and good margins. So revamp came into picture. So how revamps can be done in faster time with less of cutting and welding, the advances took place in those direction, and to increase fouling resistance in order to increase the run length. Okay, most of the things we have discussed on this slide with respect to contacting zone. So there's a contacting zone here. This is the contacting zone. This is the downflow zone, and this part is the vapor disengagement zone. So capacity limitation is either by bubbling area or by the downcomer capacity with respect to disengaging vapor and liquid. So high performance tray came into picture when the technologies were developed to increase the active area, to enhance the efficiency of the active area by using mini walls and the using of push technology. and also advanced downcomer technology and inlet area enhancements. So what was done is, in the sieve trays, they had performed some experiments that if you have 14% open area with 13 mm dia sieve holes on a tray, and for same 14% open area, if they go for 25 mm hole area, so number of sieve holes would reduce for larger hole size, but the escape area still is 14%. So they thought that probably the pressure drop would remain same, but which was not the case. With smaller holes, with the same 14% open area, the pressure drop was lesser. Lesser. There are some equations which has subsequently derived this. So for the same escape area of 14% to 14% escape area, that is escape area divided by active area, the bubbling area. So that was 14%. By keeping that same, but by reducing the hole diameter and by adding the number of holes, the pressure drop across the tray was reduced. So in turn, the capacity handling has increased. So that was the aspect that is used in high performance trays. So you will find on the high performance trays, the mini valves are used, whether fixed or floating, but a mini valve. So typical hole size is 39 mm for a valve, for a wall tray. So these valves would have a wall diameter of something like 28 or 29 mm. Because of which the number of valves they used is more. With the same escape area, they could get lesser pressure drop and in turn higher capacity. So in the market right now, this Coglitch has VG0 and MV1. VG0 is a fixed valve and MV1 is a moving valve, a mini valve. Both of these are mini valves. And Sulzer has a wall tray called MVG, mini V grade valve. So with the help of this mini valve, the active area, the utilization of active area has been enhanced, and with the help of advanced techniques for area using under the downcomer. You can imagine that the vapor which is otherwise below this, you cannot use this area because this is the inlet panel. So vapor is flowing through this cross-sectional area only. Now what was done is an inlet panel, the resist seal inlet or inlet panel has been introduced below the downcomer, and the holes are provided below this panel, and the escape holes on the length on this side. So now vapor can enter not only from this area but also from this area. The hole sizing has been dynamically adjusted in such a way that vapor can still pass. Okay, another important concept that I need to explain here is in any kind of tray, there will be a gradient of liquid flowing from entry to the downcomer. Now because of the gradient, at this zone, the liquid pool is going to be higher, whereas here the liquid pool is going to be lesser. So the resistance for vapor upflow is higher in this area because of the higher static, whereas here it is lesser. So vapor will try to take the least resistance path. So even whatever vapor is coming from here, it will try to enter from here. So which is undesirable vapor distribution. So now for liquid to flow, the gradient is going to be there. We cannot avoid that because otherwise the liquid flow will not take place. Now for higher length of higher static head, we need to balance the pressure drop in such a way that the vapor can pass through that also. So what has been done is there is two component of pressure drop. One is when the vapor passes through the tray deck, there is some pressure drop which is called as a dry tray pressure drop, and then the vapor passes through the pool of liquid, that is a liquid wet pressure drop. So here at this zone, the wet pressure drop is going to be higher. So by increasing the vapor cross-sectional area, the dry pressure drop is reduced. So now the total pressure drop in this region as well as in this region is more or less same, and that is how vapor will escape from both the regions. So by avoiding by having higher vapor cross-sectional area for vapor upflow, we are achieving balancing of the pressure drop for entry and exit zone, and because of which now vapor is entering from this zone as well. So in the conventional tray, that entry part was taking lesser participation in vapor liquid contact because of the higher resistance for vapor flow. In the high performance tray technology, even that part has been used while increasing the capacity. So that is how the area under the downcomer has been used to achieve higher vapor cross sectional area and to achieve higher capacity. Another concept on the same aspect, when from a conventional tray the liquid travels from the downcomer to the next downcomer which is feeding below, there is a possibility of the stagnant zones occurring at the periphery of the column. So this area is not contributing into the mass transfer. So what was done is the downcomer shape has been increased in such a fashion that the flow towards the periphery also is taking place without creating a stagnant zone. So this area is now utilized effectively here for additional mass transfer. And this downcomer, you can see that the downcomer residence time or volume is reduced here because of this downcomer. So you will think that the capacity of downcomer with respect to liquid handling capacity is reduced or froth handling capacity is reduced. But here the downcomer shape is an umbrella type. So when the liquid and the froth falls onto the downcomer, it will fall on that umbrella part. I'll give you a classical example. When we when somebody pours a beer in a glass of water, when he keeps it vertical, then the froth formation is higher. When he tilts the glass and pours the beer, then the froth formation is less because it is seeing more surface and hence resulting in lesser froth because of the surface tension property. So here, when the apparent type of downcomer is there, umbrella type of downcomer, so it has more surface area for froth to fall on, and because of the surface tension property, the disengagement of vapor and liquid is better. So even though the downcomer volume, residence volume or downcomer liquid holding capacity is reduced, but the effectiveness of downcomer has been increased by providing this umbrella type of downcomer. So now you need lesser downcomer size, so naturally your active area is increased, so naturally your column capacity would increase, again without compromising on the vapor liquid contact or disengagement or the efficiency part of it. So this, anyway, the person is not supposed to go from the downcomer. He has to travel from the manway panel. So there would not be any problem. So this is basically a superfract tray technology, which is developed by Koch-Litch, and the features that I have talked about, like optimum contact device, greater liquid handling capability, maximizing active area and the flow path length, improve bubbling activity distribution. There are some mechanical advances also took place with respect to mechanical strengthening and engineering features in order to reduce the installation time, in order to reduce the column modification for revamp jobs. There are various high performance trays available in the market. From Koch-Litch, it is Bifrac, Maxfrac, Nye, Superfrac, Ultrafrac trays. Sulzer has Vortex downcomer tray, Nutter MVG tray, MVG plus trays, and Norton is now bought over by Koch-Litch. So ProValve and Triton trays are now Koch-Litch products. Some of the pictures I have just shown it from Bifrac is fixed wall tray with in two directions to have better vapor liquid contact. Nye tray, Maxfrac trays, various pictures. I'll just rush through this. So depending upon which operating regime based on vapor and liquid traffic you are operating the you are going to have the column design, based on that you can have selection of which type of tray you should be using. So Superfrac tray covers a very large area of operating regime, whereas if you have a specific operating range in a mixed regime, then you can go for either Nye or Triton trays. Or if merits of trade columns, I think I'll skip through this because I'm sure you would be aware of it. Basically, again, same process requirements with respect to capacity, efficiency, the fouling, the corrosion and pressure drop. Based on these considerations, different either tray column or pack columns are chosen. Various kinds of random packing, Burl saddles, Rashi Green, then interlocks metal tower packing, which is very popularly used, Paul ring, cascade mini ring, Nutter ring. Here also the development took place with the same drivers, with respect to improving efficiency, capacity, fouling resistance. So first generation random packings were Rashid rings, just as if the pipe pieces were cut and used as a packing for vapor liquid contact. Then second generation was Paul ring. You can see that the Paul ring was nothing but the same pipe piece with slots to achieve better vapor liquid contact and wettability. When Rashid ring was used, very 100% of the specific surface area outside and inside was not really used in the mass transfer, but it was contributing onto pressure drop. So wasteful pressure drop was much more. So when the notches were provided inside and outside, vapor liquid area was the surface area was getting used for vapor liquid contact, and in turn not only it increased the contact, but it also reduced the pressure drop because of better escape area. And the third generation is basically IMTP packings, CMR packing, wherein the packing height to diameter ratio was changed, because of which the specific surface area, that is meter square per meter cube of packing, was significantly improved, which offers better vapor liquid contact onto the surface area of the packings. So these are various names of random packing: Rashid ring, Lissig ring, Burl saddles in the first generation, second generation Paul ring, interlock saddles, and third generation is IMTP, CMR, Nutter ring, Pleximax. You will get good amount of information on this on the book called Pack Column Internals by Strigel, particularly for random packings. It's a very good book. Okay, drivers for advancement in case of pack columns or packings was, again, for maximizing efficiency, lot of advances took place in an effort to maximize the surface area, in an effort to spread this the surface area uniformly and promote better vapor liquid distribution within the column and reduce the liquid holdup and to maximize the wetting. How much ever efficient packing that you put in, if the packing surface has not been properly wet, then it will not contribute into vapor liquid contact and it will not contribute into efficiency. For maximizing capacity, the advances took place in an effort to maximize void space per unit volume, minimize friction, and ensure uniform resistance to vapor liquid. So again, the main concept on which the advances took place was to maximize the useful area and minimize the wasteful area. In case of structured packing, the in 1940s Panapack, which was, if you see the asbestos rooftops, so it was arrangement of asbestos, that kind of corrugated rooftop, to achieve the vapor liquid contact to have better separations. But they realized the vapor escape area is much less, the vapor liquid distribution across the column is not uniform, and that's how the second generation of structured packing developed. That was a wire mesh packing. Wire mesh packing is a wire gauge kind of packing, which offers very good vapor liquid distribution, and it requires very less amount of liquid to wet because of the capillary action. When a drop falls on a wire, it will automatically wet the entire surface of the wire. So that is how the wettability is very high in case of wire gauge kind of packing, and in turn it offers very good efficiency. But it was very expensive, and also it was very prone to fouling due to solids. So that is how the thin metal sheet structured packing got evolved, corrugated structured packing, in 1970s. So drivers were cost, sensitivity to solids, and high capacity and retaining high efficiency. So for wire gauge BX packing, this is jointly developed by Koglitz and Sulzer, so it is called as BX packing. Corrugated sheet metal packings, there at in the market you have Flexipack, Gempack, or Melapack as the trade names for various vendors. In the structured packing, the recent advances I'll talk about is with respect to structured packing. In this, if you can see here that the two structured packing layers, when installed in the column, are rotated 90 degree to each other to achieve uniform vapor liquid distribution within the column. So what happens is, when the liquid from the layer above is flowing to the layer below, it takes a turn. It takes a turn at the intersection of the packing. Now, when the liquid and vapor is traveling onto the surface of structured packing, it is contributing into mass transfer, it is contributing into efficiency part of it. But at the transition between the two layers, there is some accumulation is taking place due to change of direction of liquid and vapor, which is creating larger pressure drop. Now this pressure drop is not contributing into the efficiency part of it. So efforts were made to identify, to eliminate or reduce this pressure drop which is occurring at the transition of the two structured packing layers. So what was done was, the bottommost part of the packing, instead of keeping it slanted, it was smoothened out. Either it was kept vertical or there is a gradual curve, because of which the transition from the layer above to layer below was made gradual, because of which the accumulation of liquid at the transition zone is reduced and in turn reduced the pressure drop, which was actually a wasteful pressure drop. So you can see here that at the intersection, the part is straightened out, because of which the transition becomes smoother. Grids are used for very high vapor liquid services, wherein the efficiency is not important, but more of heat transfer kind, direct contact cooling kind of applications, or where there is very large amount of solids are to be handled and number of theoretical stages required are very less. Various types of grids, C grid, EF25, flexi grid, snap grid, mela grid by different column internal vendors. Let me quickly run through the pack column internals also. So for packing to perform, the pack column internals are required to hold the packings. We need support plate to support the packings. To hold the packings from the on the top side, we need bed limiters or hold down plates. Liquid collectors are required for collecting and redistributing, and liquid distributors and the feed pipes. It is very important that how much ever efficient packing that we are using, the internals are to be, the pack column internals are to be appropriately designed to avoid premature flooding and to avoid excessive pressure drop across these pack column internals. In fact, most of the failures in a pack column is attributed to the liquid distributor design rather than the selection or type of packing. So chimney tray, feed pipe are other few of the column internals which are required. Chimney trays, as I discussed earlier, that it is either for collecting or partial draw, and feed pipe is feeding. You can imagine that in a small column, if you have a just single feed pipe entering the vapor from bottom or liquid from top, whatever, the distribution effort required is lesser because the diameter itself is small. But if the column diameter is pretty large, something like say 4 meter, and if you have say 40 inch pipe and just put it below the bottommost tray, then it would consume some amount of vertical length of the column for vapor to effectively get distributed. So either you need to provide that length empty to achieve that vapor distribution, or you need to have some device which will distribute it faster and reduce the length. The moment you reduce the column height, you would have significant benefit with respect to overall cost. So that is how the vapor distributors or liquid distributors are important. In case of pack column also, if you don't distribute the liquid at the first place properly in the feed pipe, then two or three layers of packings would actually get utilized in effective distribution. So there is a compromise there with respect to its contribution with respect to heat mass transfer. Just pictures of it. In liquid distributors, there are various types: gravity distributors, pressurized distributors, flashing feed, and the selection criteria depends on the liquid rate, plugging or fouling tendencies, turn down requirements, and nature of feed flow. Again, the design parameter for the liquid distributor is the design quality, which is basically drip point density. So drip point density is defined with respect to how many number of drip points are there divided by the cross sectional area. So just imagine a situation where, suppose IMTP 70 is the packing that you are using. So IMTP 70 being a large diameter packing, now the liquid dripping density required will be lesser, because if you go for say IMTP 15, each of the packing needs to see some liquid when the liquid is fed onto the packing. So you would like to have larger drip point density, larger number of drip points per meter square. If you don't provide that, then some amount of packed bed will actually get utilized in distribution of uniform distribution rather than mass transfer efficiency. Okay. In gravity distributors, there are pan distributor, pan type, that is which will have a pan and either just holes for the liquid to go down and annular area for vapor to go up. And in case of there are pan distributors with riser pipes also for vapor upflow. And then there are I'll show some of the pictures of these distributors. Okay. So this one is the orifice type distributor where there is vapor risers and liquid orifices. And this is a ladder type gravity distributor, which is just a pipe distributor. In the orifice distributor, usually is preferred for small diameter towers, and the drip tubes are provided for fouling services. If you don't provide the drip tubes and the service is fouling, then it will plug the holes, and the moment any of the holes are plugged, the uniformity of distribution will get affected adversely. So if you have the drip tubes, the whatever fouling takes place, that will sediment onto the deck of the distributor and it will not actually plug the drip tube. Drip tube will continue to drip the point, drip the liquid at the packing below. Then there is V-notched and channeled trough type of distributor. Okay, this is a trough distributor. This is a very advanced distributor wherein you are seeing here a feed pipe, then there is an inner parting box, then there is a parting box, and then there are lateral troughs, and there are diffusers as well. So in large diameter column, the complexity of design of distributor also becomes very important or very crucial. So from the feed pipe to the drip point, it is distributed, the liquid is distributed in such a way that at turn down as well as turn up condition, the liquid drop which falls onto the surface of packing will fall at the same point to ensure the desired efficiency. Just imagine that if there is, say, this lateral trough, and now at high flow condition, the liquid level in the trough will be higher. Say in this case, when the liquid low is high, at that point of time, the static head is more, and the on the surface of packing, this liquid will drip here. Whereas when the liquid level is less, then same from the same hole, liquid will drip here. So now your distribution of liquid is changing. So this is not desirable situation. So what is done is a tube is provided here. With the help of this tube, even though whatever may be the flow, the liquid will fall onto the tube and then drip down at the same point on the packing. And the two levels are provided to ensure turn up and turn down condition. In turn up condition, from both these holes, liquid will drip onto the drip tube and it will fall on the same point on the packing. And in the turn down condition, only maybe from bottom hole it will go. And any fouling or anything that is taking place can get accumulated in this area. So these are development took place to have better turn down flexibility, better resistance to fouling, and ensuring uniform vapor liquid distribution and avoiding higher pressure drop, at the same time achieving higher vapor capacities in the liquid distributor technology as well. Then there is spray nozzle headed distributors. Typically these are used wherein mass transfer as well as heat transfer has to be achieved, typically from air water kind of systems where these kind of spray header nozzles are also used. Pipe orifice headers, flash feed distributors are basically used when a two phase feed is to be fed to the column. So you can imagine that when the feeding pipe is carrying vapor as well as liquid, and if you don't provide two different paths for it, then along with vapor, if liquid also is going, then the momentum, the impact on the tray above or packed bed above will be much larger, which will lead to deterioration or falling of trays. So in such case, the slots are provided for vapor upflow and holes are provided for liquid downflow. And even above the slots, there are hoods that are provided. So whatever vapor goes up, which will carry some liquid, with the help of those sieved or slotted hoods, the liquid will be sent back in the downward direction and vapor will be escaped in the direction above. there are different types, baffle type or gallery type of liquid distributors. So let me summarize by saying that for all these column internals, be it a tray or a random packing or a structured packing or packed column internals, the primary requirement is efficiency and capacity, and the secondary requirement is to ensure the pressure drop, resistance to fouling and resistance to corrosion. You can imagine that the structured packing will be a thin metal sheet which will be say 0.1 mm or 0.2 mm, whereas trays will have a thickness of 2 mm or 3 mm. So if the surface is very highly corrosive, either you will have to go for an exotic metal while going in for structured packing, but if that is going to be too expensive, then higher thickness trays would be a better choice. So these kind of various considerations are there while selecting and designing the the column internals.
Tray thickness is of what order?
Typically minimum is 2 mm and maximum can be 3 or 3.5 mm.
That's
all? That's
it. For 12 meter dia column?
Yes, 3.5 mm. You will see more panels.
Panels will be thicker?
No, no. The tray panels, there will be multiple tray panels and multiple number of beams to give that strength.
Beam supports.
Same beam supports would be given.
The panel is means on the same tray there are the different.
See the active, the tray. Yeah. So all these panel, all these are all tray panels. Yeah, so these are tray panels. Okay, now in case of larger diameter, instead of 3, you might have 50 panels. So now the panel size and the thickness would be such that the 3 mm or 3.5 mm will be adequate. Now for these panels, there will be beams which will be running below. Say on this joint, below this there will be a beam which is running, which will give that additional strength. Now in certain cases like 12 mm columns, there are girders between the two trays that are provided, which will give support for the tray above and tray below
for this
mechanical strength. So tray number 1 will not have any support, tray number 2 and 3 there will be a girder which will support tray 1 and tray 2 likewise. So every alternate location there will be girders which will take care of tray below and tray above.
These panels probably independently they can be opened.
Yes, all these are bolted panels, so it can be independently opened.
Structured patterns like these are welded by the periphery of the same trays, conventional trays are welded by the
not welded. There will be tray support ring TSR on which it will be clamped. Welded trays had been used in the past. Very old in the initial days, welded trays, but then operation, maintenance, inspection becomes a problem. So these are all bolted trays, clamped trays.
So the vapor, the chance of vapor passing up through the gaps?
So the gap, there is a tray support ring. Okay, the tray support ring is a horizontal portion on which the tray deck will sit.
So that itself works as a seal?
It works as a seal.
And for the packings?
Yeah.
The packings, how do we take care of the sealing?
I'll show you that. Now you can't have exact diameter, outside diameter of packing cannot be exactly inside diameter of the column.
Yes.
Because there will not be a tolerance for installation. Absolutely. So typically the structured packing has something like 5 to 6 mm gap
on each side.
Yes. Now your question is right, then in such situation channeling will take place. Liquid will tend to flow to the periphery and then through the wall it will go down. So what is done is, there is a wiper band, which it is called as a wall wiper, which serves two purposes. This is a very thin metal sheet which is used to tie. If it is a small column diameter, say 400 or 600 mm, it will be a single brick, single layer of a structured packing. So you don't really require to tie it from the periphery. But imagine 800, say 4 meter or 2 meter diameter column in which structured packing is to be kept. You can't have a single brick from installation point of view. So you'll have multiple bricks which will be arranged in column and it has to be tied. So when it has to be tied, this wiper band is used. Of course, this wiper band is used for
same material as that of the packing.
And it's just a metal,
stainless steel or polypropylene, whatever it is.
And this the upper part, there will be in the packing element, there will be upper part and lower part. So it is flexible material, it is opened out. When the packing is installed, wiper band is, it's a collar kind of thing. So the collar is opened out. So when the collar is opened out, it actually touches the wall. So whatever liquid is falling from the wall, it will fall onto the collar and it will go inside. It will. In fact, this collar, if you see from close angles, it will have notches on this side, which allow the liquid to go into the packing. When it goes into the structured packing, automatically it will get spreading properly.
So what is the exact term you said, sir?
It's a wall wiper.
Wall wiper. It wipes off the liquid back to the
packing. Back to the